Hi, I'm Kirk Jowers, and I'm pleased to be with you today for a new doTERRA series about COVID-19. We are providing two foundational episodes, and the first one today is simply, what is COVID-19? We hear about it all the time in the news. Dr. Osguthorpe is going to help walk us through that. Dr. Osguthorpe, as you may know, is doTERRA's chief medical officer, but in his previous life and currently, he is a board-certified pediatric infectious diseases specialist. So, thank you for being with us.
It's good to be with you.
First question, pretty easy to ask. What is COVID-19?
So, COVID-19 is the name that we have given to the novel coronavirus that started this whole process. And specifically, COVID-19 stands for CO is corona.
Right.
VI is virus. D is disease. And 19 for the year that the virus started.
So now I have to ask, how do we get the corona? I get the rest of the words you said.
So corona or coronaviruses are a family of viruses, and they infect animals and human beings. And coronaviridae is a family that contains hundreds of different coronaviruses, different specific species of coronavirus. COVID-19 is just one of those.
So obviously, this whole family of infectious diseases, coronaviruses, have not given us a lot of trouble until this one.
Well, coronaviruses have been with human beings a long time. In fact, they cause respiratory viral illnesses, viral pneumonias in human beings, and have done so forever. They are indistinguishable usually from other viral respiratory diseases unless we do specific testing to find them.
So why is this one so special? Why is this upending everything we're doing? We're not going to watch March Madness, soccer games in Europe.
We're
canceling schools. We can't travel. That hasn't happened before because of a coronavirus, has it?
In local communities, we've done that for different epidemics, but for this one, this is the largest and most, these are the most important changes that we've made in response to a worldwide pandemic in recent memory. In 2009, we did some similar things, but we didn't go as far as we are going now. The reason why is that this particular virus has never before been seen by human beings, and that means that all of us are susceptible to it. And we are learning as we go with this virus, and we're learning how infectious it is, how it is transmitted, what it looks like in different age groups that catch it.
And let me stop you right there, because I need to know, we need to know, how does it spread? And is that part of the problem here?
It's spread person to person, and it's thought to spread through close contact by droplets. And so when we cough or sneeze, we create these droplets that can travel 3 to 6 feet, which is where we get that 6 foot number that we want to keep social distance of 6 feet from somebody else. The reason why we do that is because the droplets that we create when we cough or sneeze are of a size that they actually can only travel through the air about 3 to 6 feet before they fall out of the air and land on a surface. Airborne droplets are smaller droplets, and they can travel much further through the air, but that is not this virus. This virus is transmitted by larger droplets that can only travel 3 to 6 feet.
Can someone spread the virus without being sick, or at least without having symptoms of the disease?
There has been reports of documented transmission in other countries by people who are asymptomatic. But I would say that the most important form of transmission, by far and away the vast majority of transmission, occurs person to person through droplets.
So
when they are sick.
So okay.
Meaning, I should have been more specific. When you have symptoms is when you are most infectious. When your symptoms are at their worst is when you are most infectious. That's our current understanding. Our understanding with all things about coronavirus or COVID-19 are changing rapidly as we learn more and more and more. But as of today, that's what we understand.
Well, then what are the symptoms for COVID-19?
The symptoms for COVID-19 are a triad: fever, cough, and shortness of breath. Those are the three main symptoms of COVID-19.
So if you have those three symptoms, What should you do? If you're sick, what should people do?
When you have those symptoms, it is possible that you have COVID-19. Although I should say that currently circulating in our communities are several different respiratory viruses. And as of the filming of this episode, it is most likely that another virus is the cause of your symptoms rather than COVID-19. Later on in the epidemic, that'll change. But right now, it could be influenza or human metapneumovirus or adenovirus that are causing your symptoms. But COVID-19 has three main symptoms, and I'll say them again: fever, cough, and shortness of breath. And if you have those, you should seek medical attention. The best way to do that is to call your physician's office or where you are presenting right now and state, "I'm coming in with symptoms consistent with COVID-19. They may have a specialized way for you to present so that you don't infect or expose people within the office or healthcare workers within the office. We do want people to present to the physician who, even when they have mild symptoms that may be consistent with COVID-19. We're in the early phases of transmission in the United States. And because we're in those early phases, we want to know when you have the disease so that we can limit the spread. So anybody who is diagnosed with the disease, we would quarantine and keep away from work environments or social environments so that transmission is slowed. It may be that later on in the epidemic, we may not need to test every single person with symptoms, but that's a ways off. Okay. And so right now we want to test everybody who has symptoms of COVID-19. And to get that testing done, there will be specific ways to do that within your local state or country, wherever you are. And certain countries have made testing widely available. Certain countries have testing that's not so widely available. But in your local environment, reach out through your normal means to your physician's office, to your emergency departments, to your public health departments. Figure out what the right way is to get tested, and get tested if you present with that triad of symptoms: fever, cough, and shortness of breath. I will say that I do want to make one thing clear. COVID-19 for certain people can be very severe. And so if you have fever, cough, and shortness of breath, but it's associated with severe symptoms, meaning if you're a caregiver for one of these people at home, if it's your grandma or your grandfather, then you would want to seek emergency medical attention if that person is less arousable than usual. If you notice that they have some blue coloring to their lips, or they're really struggling to breathe, that's something where you do not pass go. You go straight to the emergency department or call an ambulance, because this disease can be severe. And so the symptoms of severe disease are: you're not arousing very well, meaning you're talking to them, but they won't respond to you normally. They're struggling to breathe. It's not that they feel short of breath, but they're struggling to breathe. And if you look at them and they appear to have blue, or we call it cyanosis, but a blue coloring around the lips, then you'd want to seek immediate medical attention.
And if someone has no symptoms, but they're just really curious if they have it, should they go see the doctor?
No. So if you're concerned about whether or not you have coronavirus, but you have no symptoms at all, no testing is required. And please don't inundate your office with calls. Everybody in the healthcare field is going to be swamped over the next few weeks. There are some exceptions, though, to your question, and that is if you've been exposed directly to a case in this early phase of the epidemic, we will be testing people around a case, and the public health department will be in charge of that. But as a general rule, if you've not been exposed to a known case of coronavirus and you don't have any symptoms, you do not need any testing.
And you get the test, you find out you have coronavirus. Are there any treatments for it?
Currently, there are studies underway to look at antiviral medications to see if they have any activity in human beings or in vitro to COVID-19. But the correct answer to your question is that currently we don't have any approved therapies that we know will work for coronavirus 19. There is also not a vaccine currently available. There's been a lot of discussion about vaccine availability. It will take many months for a vaccine to be fully tested and approved. And, you know, when we listen to the directors of the CDC and NAAID, it will take us upwards of 8 months to a year to have a vaccine that has been fully tested and ready to go. So right now, the most important thing we can do is limit transmission of the virus and wash our hands, limit social contact, clean surfaces, do those things that are up all over the World Health Organization page and the CDC and others about limiting spread.
How deadly is it, and who is most at risk?
The people who are at most at risk of having severe disease from COVID-19 are the elderly and those who have health conditions making COVID-19 more complicated. Those conditions would include respiratory diseases, chronic respiratory diseases, type 2 diabetes, compromised immunity states. Those folks will have more difficulty with the virus. But the main population, as we've looked at this virus for the last 6 months, that is impacted severely are the elderly, those over 60. So if you're over 60 and you have chronic lung disease, you would want to limit your social contact and try and control your environment as much as possible to decrease the likelihood that you will get the disease.
And I think the question everyone wants to know is when will this disruption that we're experiencing now end? Is there any way to predict when life goes back to normal?
That's a really hard question. I appreciate you asking. The answer to the question is, truthfully, I cannot give you a date. If we had a crystal ball that good, we'd use it.
Yeah.
But most epidemiologists are feeling that this virus will be with us as a global population for years. And what we want to do is spread out the time frame that people come into contact with the virus so that the epidemic curve flattens rather than is very steep. If we can do that, our healthcare system will be able to handle the influx of patients that need care.
So, because when you say steep, the problem with that is we go way beyond the capacity of
the healthcare system
to accommodate people.
That's exactly right. And we really don't want that. We want the people who need care to be able to receive care and not have every bed be full of a critically ill patient. And so to do that, we want to limit transmission. But in answer to how long that will be, well, when we flatten the curve, that means that it's going to take us longer to get back to normal, or whatever you define as normal is.
Right.
But what I would say is that we would anticipate that the virus will be infecting large numbers of people for the next year. And we just want it to happen over a long period of time rather than a short period of time, because if it happens over a short period of time, those who get severe illness won't be able to access the kind of care that they need within our medical system.
Well, thank you so much for being with us for this foundational episode. Thank you for watching, and I hope that you will watch every evening when we bring out a new episode that updates you on that day's events and gives you more information that we believe will be helpful for you in protecting yourself and your family and for the community around you.
Until then, take care of each other and take care of those that you love.